Welcome to the first forum of the second year of the forum, and I want to start by thanking all of you and your predecessors, because all of you have made the forum what it has become, which is pretty cool. I'm Barry Friedman. I'm going to introduce the panel in just a moment. We're having a technology issue, which is me. And I'm going to then tell you the ground rules for the forum. But let me first thank a few people that I think deserve a thank right at the very beginning of the year. So I think Vice Dean Jeannie Forrest is still here. Thank you for all of your support for the forum. And to Nick Vagelatos and Joseph Biondi, where I don't know where you guys are, but they're at the door. So thank you for all of that. So here's how the forum works. It is largely about you, and it is a chance to learn about something that is important and timely or provocative and then have a conversation about it. So all of the speakers have been instructed that they have 6 minutes max. So we'll take up about a half an hour up front to sort of bring us all up to speed on the issue. And then after that, we're going to go to you, as we always do, for about 45 minutes of questions. And we'll end promptly at 1:45 because I know many of you and I actually have a class at 2. So I'm going to introduce the panelists and we'll get started. To my, by the way, I want to make sure that I point out that this is co-sponsored by the Guarini Center for Environmental Law and Land Use Law here at NYU. So to my far right, we have Amy Salzman, who's a graduate of the law school. Amy is always good, is the associate director for policy outreach at the Council on Environmental Quality at the White House. Amy started her career in the Environment Division of the U.S. Department of Justice. She then worked for some nonprofits and is now back in government. I'm sure Amy's going to say this, but I'll state the obvious, which is given the continuing nature of the events we're going to talk about today, she is constrained in some ways in what it is that she is going to be able to say. To my immediate right is Al Wong, who is the head of the National Resource Defense Council's Environmental Justice Program. Al has been deeply involved in events in the Gulf Coast reaching back to Hurricane Katrina, and so he brings a tremendous amount of insight to what's going on there now. To my left is a man who probably needs very little introduction here for many of you, and if not yet, then eventually, if you end up in his class. He's Richard Stewart. He's a university professor and the John Edward Sexton Professor here at the law school. He's the head of the Hauser Global Law Program. He's the director for the Center of Environmental and Land Use Law, and I'm sure he has time to do other things as well. He's one of the foremost, if not the foremost, leading administrative and environmental expert in the country. I'm cautious to say that he's the foremost, since the dean might object. But perhaps most importantly, from 1989 to 1991, Dick was the Assistant Attorney General in the Department of Justice for Environment and Natural Resources and led the prosecution regarding the Exxon Valdez. And finally, to my far left is Richard Epstein, who I am happy to welcome full-time to our faculty this year. We've seen a lot of Richard over the past few years, but he's now here full-time. He's the Lawrence Tisch Professor of Law here at NYU. He is one of the nation's leading experts on property, torts, pretty much anything Richard decides to put his mind to, and I'm sure he's going to have a lot to tell us today. So we're going to get started. Amy, you're off.
Thanks, Barry. It's working. It's really fun to be back here at Vanderbilt Hall. It's been quite a while since I went to school here. And I just wanted to just note how different the investment of this school in environmental issues has grown since I was here. I mean, when I was here, you took ad law, and there was the Environmental Law Clinic, thank you, NRDC. And now NYU has become really a leader in environmental law policy and practice. And I just want to give a nod to Peter over here, who, as a result of all these changes at NYU, had a very successful summer at CEQ this past summer. And I look forward, I mean, he probably knows more about what I'm talking about with you today than I do, because he helped write this report I'm going to tell you about. So I've got to get going because I have a time limit. I've been asked to talk with you about the role of the White House Council on Environmental Quality and the Deepwater Horizon oil spill. But first, I'll tell you a little bit about CEQ and how and why we're involved. CEQ was created 40 years ago by the National Environmental Policy Act, which is really the bedrock law with respect to environmental policy. NEPA passed Congress with overwhelming bipartisan support back in the olden good days, and was signed into law by President Nixon in 1970. That was a big year for the environment. The Clean Air Act passed, EPA was created, CEQ was created, I think NOAA was created, the National Oceans and Atmospheric Administration. Really, 40 years ago was a red letter day. In addition to creating CEQ to advise the president on all things environmental and coordinate environmental policy across the federal government, NEPA also imposed for the very first time an affirmative obligation on all federal agencies to think about the environment before they make a decision that might affect the environment. It also was designed to create a huge amount of transparency and public engagement in environmental policy matters. In essence, NEPA said to the federal government, think before you jump. So NEPA provides three basic tools for environmental analysis. There is the full-blown environmental impact statement, or EIS, that a federal agency must prepare when an action of theirs will have significant environmental effects. There is a lesser analysis called an environmental assessment that can be used to determine if you're not sure whether or not your action will have a significant environmental effect. And then there are things called categorical exclusions, which an agency can apply based on their past experience and environmental reviews of similar actions. If the agency determines that a proposed action falls within that category of actions that don't normally have a significant impact on the environment, then they don't need to do any further environmental analysis. I've told you all that stuff because it's really relevant to what we did with respect to the oil spill. Our involvement, that is CEQ's involvement in the Deep Water Horizon disaster, began actually on April the 20th, the day that the tragic explosion killed 11 people. Under the applicable laws, the federal government created a National Incident Command to oversee the response efforts. Those efforts were and continue to be overseen by Thad Allen, the former commandant of the Coast Guard, and he continues to lead an interagency team. I can just give you a small anecdote. The president had arranged for a nice celebration of the 40th anniversary of Earth Day, another big 40th this year, on the 22nd of April, 2 days after the spill. Instead of spending time talking with all the folks outside, you could see him in the Oval Office talking about the oil spill with his senior advisors. Well, the good news is the well was successfully capped on July 15th. The bad news is that almost 5 million barrels of oil flowed into the Gulf of Mexico from the wellhead, which was about a mile below the surface of the ocean. The president has called this the worst environmental disaster America has ever faced. As you may know, the what they call the bottom kill, which is this, they've been digging another well sort of into the existing well to kill it from the bottom. Thad Allen, I think, the day before yesterday, approved that process to go into, I think, final form. Assuming the weather holds, that should happen sometime soon. CEQ's principal involvement with respect to this bill has been in three ways. One is we did a review of the Mineral Management Service, which is the entity within the Department of Interior who was responsible to oversee offshore oil, gas, and oil activities. We did a review of their NEPA processes, which is something that CEQ was charged by the law to do. We are working on the long-term restoration of the Gulf, and we have been doing very robust stakeholder engagement activities. So looking first at our review of the Mineral Management Service's NEPA processes, in May, CEQ and the Department of Interior announced a review of the NEPA policies, practices, and procedures applied by MMS. Our report, which was released in August, concluded that while MMS conducted numerous levels of extensive environmental reviews to consider the environmental impacts of outer continental shelf OCS activities, their NEPA process could be improved in some areas. The Department of the Interior has since that time reorganized MMS into something called the Bureau of Ocean Energy Management Response and Enforcement. We call it the BOEM. And they have committed to actually using our recommendations that Peter helped write as basically guideposts as they are now going forward to reform their NEPA activities. And the CEQ will continue to work with them as they do this. The BOEM has agreed to perform careful and comprehensive NEPA review of individual deep water exploration activities and to track and take into account all mitigation commitments. One of the things that an entity can do is to promise to mitigate any harm. But sometimes people lose track of those commitments in the many layers of environmental analysis that goes on. And one of the things that they agreed to do was to do a better job of tracking it and also layering the information that they get from the various levels of environmental review. They also agreed to ensure that NEPA analyses fully inform and align with substantive decisions at all relevant decision points, that subsequent NEPA analyses accurately reflect and carry forward relevant underlying data, and very importantly, that all those analyses be fully available to the key decision makers and to the public. In addition, the BOEM committed to ensuring that NEPA documents provide decision makers with robust analyses of reasonably foreseeable impacts, including those associated with what we call low probability catastrophic spills for oil and gas activities on the outer continental shelf. On August 18th, the Department of Interior and BOEM announced that they will also restrict their use of categorical exclusions, those things that I described at the beginning that you can use if you do something often and it has no environmental impact, which they had been using, and which they're now doing a comprehensive review and will be releasing information later in the fall, a proposed regulation. DOI and the BOEM also announced that they intend to complete a supplemental environmental impact statement for the whole Gulf of Mexico leasing area. With respect to long-term Gulf restoration, in October of last year, President Obama formed a Louisiana-Mississippi Gulf Coast Restoration Working Group to be co-led by my office and the Office of Management and Budget. About a month before the BP tragedy, the working group released its roadmap for Gulf Coast ecosystem restoration, which emphasized the protection and restoration of coastal ecosystems as a key element to the long-term safety and viability of the region. About a month later, the well blew. And of course, the work of that task force has become even more critical. In June, President Obama instructed all the federal agencies to work together to create a long-term Gulf Coast restoration support plan, and he assigned Secretary Mabus, who's the Secretary of the Navy, to lead the effort, and he asked the Secretary to deliver the report as soon as possible. The Gulf Coast Ecosystem Restoration Working Group, the first one that we worked on, has informed the process that Secretary Mabus is undertaking to develop that plan, and our efforts are combined with the many departments and agencies who will participate in the long-term restoration of the Gulf's ecosystems. And finally, our office has initiated weekly information sharing conversations with Gulf stakeholders, and we started doing this just a few weeks after the well blew. Every week, we get experts from all across the federal government to provide information and updates about what we're doing and what we're learning to almost more than 700 folks are now on these calls. And we actually engage in a conversation with them because they're often know more than we do about the actual on-the-ground impacts. And we try very hard to adjust every week's call to reflect what we hear from folks in the ground. And we've actually learned a lot from them. So in conclusion, President Obama has confirmed that while the well is no longer leaking, he is committed to working until the environment has been restored, no matter how long it takes, that we'll do whatever is necessary to help the Gulf Coast and its people recover from this tragedy and make sure that a catastrophe like this will never happen again. So I look forward to our conversation.
Thank you, Amy. Al?
Hello. Hi. Thanks for putting this panel together. Appreciate being here. And also great to see a lot of former interns that we've had at NRDC and who participate in our environmental law clinic. So this is kind of a plug for those who might be interested in doing that. I've been asked, my name is Al Huang. I'm an environmental justice attorney at Natural Resources Defense Council. We're a public interest group, a national public interest group, focused on environmental issues. We've been around for 35 plus years. And have offices all around the country, and 1.6 million members and online activists. That's a term we have to repeat.
I started in 1970
also. Yes, we did. And I've been asked to talk about the public interest side of the oil spill. And NRDC is among many groups, national and local, that are working on oil response. And so I thought I would just kind of go through, talk about what we're doing, and what a lot of the issues on the ground that people who are, communities are trying to recover from the oil spill are facing, and in the context of, you know, the federal response and then the long-standing legal issues afterwards. So the work that NRDC is doing down there is, I mean, there's many different aspects to it. One side is looking at drilling itself, and Amy talked a little bit about the issues with how those permits were issued before, categorical exclusions. We're litigating some of the rigs that did get permits, and they did have a categorical exclusion. We're trying to relitigate some of those, representing local groups. And we're looking also at reforming some of the issues that led to the disaster in the first place. Part of it's the MMS reform issue that Amy mentioned earlier, as well as looking at the oil spill, the Oil Pollution Control Act, and whether that's appropriate to protect our natural resources and communities after an oil spill. And then there's another aspect is the on-the-ground response. And myself and our health team, which we have on staff at NRDC, not just lawyers, but we also have scientists and physicians. And our work kind of grows out from our work that we did after Hurricane Katrina. And I think it's a relevant story to talk about what the community is like down the Gulf Coast. I mean, we're talking Texas, Louisiana, Mississippi, Alabama, and Florida. And traditionally, the Gulf Coast has been underserved in many ways, not only in disparities in environmental pollution from large oil and gas activities and exploration activities that have gone on for decades in the region. I mean, there's an area in Louisiana called Cancer Alley, which is a stretch of 40 miles from New Orleans to Baton Rouge, which has over 140 petrochemical facilities, and 80% of people living within a mile of it are African-American people of color in low-income communities. And there's long-standing history of the environmental and the social impacts of oil and gas drilling. So a lot of this, although in the news, everyone's like, oh my God, I can't believe this is happening. This is horrible for communities. Many communities down there will say, we've been living with this our entire lives. And it's very much intertwined. Many of them depend on it for jobs as well. And then when you start looking at the other big industry in that region, which is fishing, they've long lived with this relationship with fishers and oil and gas. I mean, a great example is in Plaquemines Parish of Louisiana. This is the Louisiana Bayou, where there's some of the world's richest wetlands. A lot of the oyster fishermen there have seen over the years how the drilling of natural gas pipelines and canals to bring oil and gas in and out have essentially torn up the wetlands and also led to a lot of saltwater intrusion into freshwater, which affects oystering in that region. And also have natural disasters like Hurricane Katrina came in and really destroyed a lot of the wetland areas because many of them were being overdeveloped in many cases by the oil and gas industry. And so, I mean, there is a long history that folks have living with the impacts of oil and gas drilling. However, I think the oil spill is kind of what put people at least over the top as far as trying to recover from Katrina. And like I said, there's a long history of disparities, not just in environmental burdens, but also in just social services like healthcare and other services that keep the fabric of the communities together. And some of the issues that people really have voiced as their main issues, and are some more surprising. I mean, one is you would think, right after the oil spill occurred, of course, many areas, and they still are, closed for fishing. And when I say fishing, it's not just like fish fishing, but shrimping, it's oystering, and as you all know, it's a big resource for the rest of the country. A lot of our seafood comes from this region, and it's part of the identity of a lot of people who live in this region. One of their first concerns was, they couldn't fish, so what are they going to do? And of course, I'm sure we'll have some discussion later on about, how those people are being compensated, and what are the laws that, Oil Pollution Control Act is one of them, that help compensate people who've lost their livelihood because of an oil spill. So that's one side. The other side was, since they didn't have, a lot of these fishermen couldn't fish anymore, they started taking new jobs. Many of them were doing cleanup activities for BP, going out in the skimming boats, cleaning up, deploying the booms. And many of them were saying that, they weren't getting adequate health protection. So that's something that we looked at and we worked with them to identify what those issues were, to get EPA and other agencies to really do good monitoring, especially for, oil, it's well known that oil has a lot of contents in it that pose human health risks. I mean, there's heavy metals and there are what we call hydrocarbons, polyaromatic hydrocarbons and some other chemicals like benzene that are well known and studied to have human health impacts. So what does it mean when this much oil is spilled, not only into an ecosystem, but an ecosystem where humans, have a tight connection with not only as a food source, but also as a resource in which, they recreate in and they depend on for their livelihood as far as tourism, fishing, and other industries in the region. So one issue we've looked at is worker health and safety. I mean, are these workers being protected? There was a big discussion about workers getting sick who had been out working and many of them believed it was dispersants. I'm sure this is another thing, anyone who's opened a paper heard the word dispersants, and it's like, what is this chemical? Why don't we know much about it? And I think one of the things it's done, it's renewed an issue that not only communities but environmental groups have been saying for a long time, is that when we approve for use chemicals in the greater economy, that we really need to have appropriate testing. And the dispersants that were used were a great example of how TSCA, the Toxic Substance and Control Act, has failed us. I mean, why are chemicals that we know very little about, where there's very little testing, why are they allowed to be used at such large quantities before we know much about them? And I think that's something that EPA has recognized, and as well as NOAA, And they've gone and they're doing a lot of work as far as trying to figure out what are those human health impacts. I mean, in Europe and some other areas, they've banned the use of these chemicals. And you know, what does that say? I think I think what it's done is it's got a lot of people on the ground thinking about, you know, I never thought about that before. And you know, now that I have to live with this legacy, you know, they've taken on, you know, like a lot of advocacy zeal in saying, you know, this is something that's important for us to look forward to in the future. So that's one issue. Another issue is seafood safety. One would think that fishermen, once they reopen areas, and there have been some areas that have been reopened for fishing, you wouldn't think that fishermen would be all over it. But it turns out that many fishermen are concerned, not only because they're afraid that the product that they depend on might be tainted. Let's say they do find oil, and they say they still see oil everywhere. If you open the paper now, everyone will say the oil is gone. But I mean, we all know that there's still these subsurface plumes. They've been very well studied and established. And what is that long-term impact on the fisheries? And so, a lot of the fishermen are concerned about the long-term livelihood and the credibility of the product, but even more so is they are also subsistence fishermen. They don't just fish and then sell the fish, they eat that fish and they feed their families on it, and they're concerned. I mean, and realistically they should be. I mean, what are the long-term impacts? And just to give you a quick example of how, you know, some of these issues are real, I mean, FDA and NOAA are responsible for looking at seafood safety, and one of the things they've done is they have to do these risk assessments. So they're basing, for example, the annual consumption of seafood as the average, just saying, well, the average person on the Gulf Coast eats 4 pieces of shrimp once a week. Anyone who's been down the Gulf Coast knows. I mean, that's like a quarter of a po' boy sandwich. And so, I mean, there definitely are areas that, you know, need more public scrutiny, and part of what NRDC is doing is engaging with the public to identify those, working with the relevant federal agencies to try to address them, and in the same time also working on access to data and information.
That's terrific, Al. Dick.
So the oil spill and the response to it are really an elephant of a topic, and we're each groping at different parts of it. And I'm going to look at it from the perspective of a federal government enforcer, drawing for comparison on my experience with the Exxon Valdez spill. First of all, sir, what are the legal tools available to the federal government? Now, here we have a range of statutes, the Clean Water Act, the Oil Pollution Act, the Rivers and Harbors Act, the Migratory Bird Treaty Act, the Endangered Species Act are the prominent ones. And what are the hammers that the federal enforcers can use? Criminal, civil penalties, removal costs, and natural resource damages are going to be the main heads. Criminal, Clean Water Act. The violation here is the discharge of oil without a permit. That's what was true in Exxon, too. Absolutely. How do you get your permit in advance? Well, there's a question. For a negligent violation, the fine is $25,000 a day. You can't incarcerate a corporation. Maybe there are some individuals who will face prosecution, but a negligent violation is a crime, and then a knowing violation is a more serious crime, a felony, with $50,000 a day. But there's a kicker called the Alternative Fines Act that was enacted in 20 years ago, or more than 20, 25 years ago, to deal primarily with financial fraud, and says, in lieu of the penalties prescribed in a federal criminal statute, the federal government can seek criminal penalties up to twice the amount of the pecuniary gain obtained by the violator or the loss resulting from the violation. And people have argued this could apply to an environmental case, to an oil spill. And it was used in a settlement, but its application, pecuniary, no gain here to BP, but loss. Can we say damage to the environment or economic losses to private parties are within the meaning of this statute? That'll be an interesting issue. All right. Civil penalties. So in addition to the criminal violation, there's no double jeopardy to hit you also with civil penalties. And the civil penalties here were discharged without a permit. In the Exxon case, at that time, the maximum penalty was $25,000 per day. And it was only one day, right? So. But after the Exxon spill, the Oil Pollution Act was enacted with additional provisions for liability, and the Clean Water Act was amended to have the penalty based on barrels released. And it's the maximum penalty is now in excess of $4,000 per barrel, which translates in the case of this spill to about 20, maybe 28 or $30 million a day. And there are many days, so that adds up to a very high number. Then there are the removal costs. That is the cost of not only removing the oil, but preventing damage to the environment. And that's done under the supervision of the Coast Guard as the on-scene coordinator with the cooperation here of BP. Al mentioned some of the issues. Well, is the cleanup doing more harm than good? If you're using hazardous dispersants, in the Exxon spill, I flew around the island shortly after the spill. They were steam cleaning the beaches. They were wiping the rocks with rags. Well, the rags, that doesn't hurt anything. But steam cleaning the beaches looked good, but it killed every little thing on the beaches and retarded the recovery. It actually made it, in some cases, the response was worse than the spill. So you have to be careful about that. But those costs are unlimited. And then the real kicker here is natural resource damages. Injury to natural resources, who can bring those? Trustees. Who are the trustees of the resources? Well, federal, state, and tribal agencies that manage or regulate them. So in this case, there are going to be three or four federal agencies. Every one of the states borders the Gulf can be said to be affected by the spill will have its trustees, and there'll probably be some tribal claimants. So who's in charge? Nobody. And how do you value injury to the environment? How do you put a price tag? Well, you can try and say it's the cost of restoration, but how do you restore the Gulf of Mexico? People have argued there are diminished use values. You can't use the beach, you can't go fishing, and there are ways actually for economists to develop to measure those values. But how do you put a price tag on the despoilation of the environment? People have said we can go around and ask people how much they're willing to pay to avoid something like this. You try and do it in a neutral way. You don't refer to the spill because people are excited about it. You're trying to get a neutral economic valuation. But of course, people can respond to those surveys. They don't actually have to pay. So this is a huge problem, how you put a value and how you spend. And one of the ironies here is that the relevant statutes, the Water Act and Oil Pollution Act, say that the recoveries in the case of the federal agencies can be recovered directly by those agencies without further appropriation by Congress. Fines go into the Treasury. Civil penalties recovered by the government go into the Treasury. Congress has to appropriate the monies if they're going to be spent. But in the case of natural resource damages, they go directly to the agencies to spend for restoration. Great, you think, because the idea was we want to make sure the monies go back to restore the environment. But bureaucratic incentives, this is free found money for these agencies. We're talking about pork, green pork, but pork. And the scramble for the pork was not a pretty sight. And in my sense, a lot of the money was just wasted. I tried to have a single, this is what I'd like Amy to do, a single federal trustee and a single trustee for all the states to get together and spend this money sensibly. But that's going to be an uphill battle with the various client agencies. Two more points. One, how is this going to be resolved? It's got to be settled. To litigate the natural resource damages from start to finish, let's say in the Exxon case or this case, would take 20 years because you have discovery, all of this stuff, and the ranges of liability are vast. The criminal case or the threat of the criminal case will drive settlement because no discovery, no protracted proceedings, you go to trial, and that's going to bring the incentives to litigate and once you settle, you want to settle the entire package. Final point, given the liabilities that I've described that BP was facing, how could this spill happen? Our laws tend to look at the enforcement as, well, we're going to tell you what you can't do. You can't discharge without a permit. And there are other operating requirements. But if you violate those, we're going to whack you. And here there seems to have been an internal process management problem. After Three Mile Island, the nuclear industry and the Nuclear Regulatory Commission got together and said, we have to focus on the training of the personnel that are on the scene. We have to focus on the management quality control assurances. Typically, we leave this to the industry. In this case, highly hazardous deep drilling, we may not be able to.
Thanks, Dick. I'm still struggling with the pork, green, scrambled. I'm thinking there's a Dr. Seuss story there. Richard.
Thank you very much. My job here, as usual, is to sort of be the Grinch that stole Christmas.
I sleep late.
And what I'm going to try to do is to sort of explain how it is that you want to examine this thing from the point of view of BP, which I have no connections with. I'm happy to say that I was involved in the Three Mile Island litigation on a farcical effort on the plaintiffs to recover damages, and I'm well aware of the fact that some of these splendid devices, which are designed to make sure that things won't go wrong, have the added consequences of making sure that things won't happen at all. There has been no new nuclear facility in the United States that has been opened and licensed since Three Mile Island, and if we do that with respect to oil wells, I don't think that's a record that we want to emulate. So the question then is, if you think about this case, what do you do from the point of BP, and how do you think about this as a common law dispute? And I want you to think about it from the defendant's point of view, not because I think they're right on every point, but because it shows you just how difficult it is when you have righteous indignation on your side against the defendant who's relatively tenacious and wants to fight each and every point. Well, the first thing I think that would happen is that if you're defending this as a common law matter, you are not going to worry very much about the permits. The common law systems on nuisances talks about discharges to strangers, the permits are irrelevant and so forth. The question then is, why might they matter? And the answer would be, if there is these systematic violations on these things, you can be hit for recklessness and therefore for lose all your benefits of caps and possibly exposed to punitive damages. And this is something for which BP's optimal strategy, in my view, is not to contest liability, which they have chosen not to do, not to try to claim refuge between any of the statutory safe havens, all of which are worthless in its case. You'd rather concede the liability on this issue in order to keep some of the bad stuff out about the way in which the wells were managed and so forth, because those things would only have a tendency to inflame juries in ways that won't work for your benefit. So I think the first strategy or line of defense for the defendants are to surrender. And I think that many lawyers understand the importance of not fighting losing battles. Then the question is, where are you going to fight? And one of the places you're going to fight is on the very complicated questions of proximate causation. And what you have to do when you're dealing with proximate causation is essentially go down the chain of events from the initial eruption to the ultimate damage for which somebody's trying to claim relief, and try to find as many things that take place between the date of the original release and the particular claim to which you can say are incremental factors which ought to bear the liabilities in question. What you do when you want to defend one of these cases is what you take after is the government. And say that they are, in effect, people whom you cannot sue in these circumstances, but their particular activities have, in fact, been violently counterproductive with respect to the activities in question. Now, there are going to be really difficult questions of fact on this thing, so I'm not saying that the points are true. What I'm trying to do is to say why it is that when you're a good lawyer, you're going to try to look for these things. What might be the things that you would want to look for? Well, you're clearly not going to have any purchase with respect, I think, to the initial erosion or the death of the 11 people on the particular platform. But when the cleanup efforts start to begin, or the controlling efforts start to begin, you have what I now will call the Stewart problem, which is, have you done more harm than good? So if you have the question of trying to manage the leak in order to close this thing down, and you have government directives and industry people in conflict with one another, you're literally going to have to go through the entire sequence and argue that this spill would have been controlled, if you could make the case out, as of June 15th, except that the government required us to do certain kinds of things which we ought not to have done. These exaggerated the situations. Given the fact that they have sovereign authority over the situation and controlled our decisions, you have to take those incremental costs and say either they're borne by the government explicitly or they're not going to be borne by us. You cannot hold us responsible for the kinds of wrongs that are committed by others. There's going to be a big battle as to whether that's the correct legal proposition, but I think it's something you have to understand. As the oil starts getting out there, then the question is, what kind of efforts do you use to sort of cabin and contain it? And there are all sorts of allegations out there, for example, about what kinds of technologies we have available. One of my friends, Henry Miller, who works at the Hoover Institution, says that the government restrictions with respect to the development of bacterial tactics in order to dissolve and to eat the oil are a major source of problems in this case, and that what you're looking at are technologies that are 30 years out of date because of other forms of government regulation. Can you bring that to bear in order to influence the amount of damages? The Dutch were said to have various kinds of sophisticated oil skimmers that were kept out of American waters by the United States public authorities. Was it true? If they had come in, what kind of stuff would have been able to do? There are private people who are trying to erect booms, and it turns out that their ability to create these self-devices may have been restricted by either federal or state kinds of actions. How did that impact the flow and so forth? So you go down this thing. I mean, there is no shortcut on a proximate cause issue. No matter how complicated the chain, a good defendant's lawyer never will allow a plaintiff to say, your spill caused this loss. What you do is you say, my spill caused the release, after which all of these things there. It's a common theory of causation. Defendants are strippers. They break everything out. Plaintiffs are lumpers. Everything just sort of comes together in one seamless whole. You have to control the discourse on causation if you are going to be able to succeed at all. Next class of losses that you're going to worry about is you get the administration deciding on moratoriums for deep wells, small wells, whatever it is. To what extent can those losses be hit against BP? There's no gain for them from this stuff. Do you attribute this to a completely hysterical government response aided on by activists, environmental activists who don't know what they're doing? Or do you say, oh, no, no, these are necessary and prudent responses because of everything that's going to happen in these particular cases? I think that this is actually a very hard question. The current law, I actually think, would probably say that once the government decides to impose these restrictions, since it has complete control over that process, the lost profits are not going to be charged to BP. But you can think of a theory of proximate cause, which would make even that a kind of a necessary response to a public danger, and you could start to see there. So that's one thing. Then the question is, who's a plaintiff, which I've suppressed and which Dick Stewart hinted at. It's a very hard question. You get the destruction of natural resources that have no private owners, so the usual mechanism of tort doesn't work. There is no natural party who could claim the ownership of non-owned things, could mean the fact that you've got multiple jurisdictions, Indian tribes, fishermen who use them, and so forth. And so part of what the defense effort is to say, there's only one set of damages for one set of losses. You guys either come together and be coherent about it, but you cannot first sue us as owners of the land, and then sue us as fishermen for their losses, then the environmental harm losses, then the contingent valuation losses. You have to make sure that these are coherent and they're not multiplicable. The second question that you have to face on this, are there a broad class of losses which in fact are economically real, but it turns out to be legally non-tenable, or what lawyers like to say, they're non-cognizable, we don't recognize them. So if you go back to the classic theory of tort, if you make a nuisance spill and the water comes up on the beach, and there's somebody whose business is essentially to supply food to the restaurant, which has the beachfront property that's damaged, and they lose all of their custom in virtue of the fact that no customers come. First of all, you got two issues. One, does the owner of the beach only recover for the damage to the beach, or does it recover also for the loss of custom? It's going to be a tricky question. And then all of the suppliers and potential customers who would otherwise go there, do they have an action for their economic loss even though they've not been physically injured? The usual rule on that has been to deny the second class of claims and to be equivocal on the first. My own prediction is that that's not necessarily going to hold up. These losses are sufficiently pervasive, and the usual argument that, gee, mitigation is always available to these remote parties may not be so good when it's entire Gulf that has turned out to be decimated. So I think you'll have to defend this very hard if you're BP, but this is an area in which there turns out to be expensive potential exposure. And the last point that I'll mention, because time is running, is you're going to have to figure out how it is that you integrate what's going on in this private damage action through the class action facilities. That's going to be a nightmare, whether or not the class is too big, too small, or just right. You're going to have to figure out the offsets for the money that are going to be handed out through the Feinberg Commission, and those are not going to be, as it were, final settlements, but down payments, and how you integrate all of those things. And then you're going to have to also ask whether or not there are any offsets for criminal fines that have been paid or cleanup expenses that have been paid elsewhere. 20 years is a very nice framework in which to think about this thing. BP will, in fact, have an enormous number of very viable defenses so long as they put themselves, and I will end on this note, in the following frame of mind. We're not contesting liability. What we're trying to do is to say that the proper measure of damages happens to be X, and these miscreants from the government simply decide that they're going to use 10X as the appropriate measure of damages. And so the lesson that you learn is if you could win on the remedial side, you may be able to dampen your exposures by a factor of 5 or 7 or 10. And for a good defense lawyer, that's where you have to be thinking in this case, not on the grand issues of why it is that pollution is a sign of industrial vigor and help, and so that everybody ought to encourage its incurrence. I don't think that's the winning line. Thank you.
Thank you, Richard. So we're going to start to take questions. I've got two folks with mics. Where are the two of you? There's one, and there's the other. Raise your hand if you want to ask a question. I just want to tell everyone this works best if both the questions and the answers are short and crisp, and if the folks up here don't feel the need, each of them, to answer every question. Who's got a question? It actually goes most efficiently if there are no questions. I see an arm all the way in the back. And while we move the mic there, is there another question for the next mic over here somewhere? Has anybody got a question on this side of the room? Right here in front, so if we can move the mic here. Yes.
Hi, thanks.
Why don't you stand up and tell us who you are and where you stand in law school?
My name is Martha Roberts, and I'm a 2L.
Thanks.
I was wondering, one of the many upsetting aspects of the oil spill was my sense was that it really delayed and set us back in terms of advancing climate policy. And I was wondering if you could speak to whether you would agree with that statement and why you think that was the case.
How do you base that on an assumption that it did set back climate policy, and that wasn't set back before the oil spill. I mean, like, you maybe like at least further explain like what you want me to.
Well, I guess I was surprised that if you would compare it to the Exxon Valdez spill, which I felt like really galvanized public opinion.
We have to use the mic.
Behind greater environmental protection, I really didn't feel that sentiment coming out of this environmental catastrophe, and I would wonder why you thought that was the case.
Well, again, I mean, there are many reasons why the climate bill did not succeed, and whether the oil spill or not affected it, I mean, I think you can look back in hindsight, but I think, you know, definitely after the oil spill occurred, there was a thought that, you know, there would be some type of connection made, that, you know, that it's unsustainable to continue business as usual, that we need to start looking at alternative sources. But, I mean, it's tough to tie existing oil exploration to, you know, CO2. I mean, you can make it tie to CO2 emissions, but I think what is the link between the two? And I think that's where maybe the environmental movement could have done a better job, is making that link and, you know, saying here's why we need. I think the messaging has been, you know, this is the infrastructure, and the reason why the spill happened was because of our, you know, addiction to oil, and but for that we wouldn't have been drilling at such a rate with such irresponsible regulation. No offense taken to the administration, and if we had, you know, diversified our energy portfolio, perhaps we would not have had this type of disaster. I mean, I think that's an if. You're not really sure type question, but I mean, it definitely, I think the message was lost as far as, you know, why does this mean you need to move on an energy bill? So I think that's
one other answer.
Oh, yes. I mean, I would want to say quite a different answer is thank God. that is, look, the reason why the two things are negatively correlated is, for the most part, much of the stuff with this designed to deal with the carbon dioxide science and the potpourri of remedial stuff into it is in the area of the ethereal and the indefensible, either in terms of the nature of the temperature changes or the responses to it. What happens is when you start to see a real live flesh and blood disaster with blood, gore, fish, and so forth, you can't do that for carbon carbon dioxide. You can't get within a country mile of that. And so you're asking a country now to figure out how to spend its scarce resources. Do you want to throw yourself into something in which the entire operation of the climate research unit at East Anglia University is called into question, or do you want to deal with the kinds of things for which we know that there's some sort of a serious problem for a serious control? And then in terms of dealing with the policies here, the first question you want to ask is, why in the world do we allow people to drill at 3,500 or 5,000 feet when if you go off to Alaska, you could drill in water of 150 or 200 feet, cordon off a few caribou, and simply get the same amount of oil for a lot less money out of the ground? I mean, and the last thing you want to do, I want to be very emphatic about this, is to use this as an excuse for some phony industrial policy in which the government starts to pick winners by promising to create thousands of clean energy jobs. What the United States government ought to do on the question of climate research is go to sleep, create a tax structure which is relatively flat, and let entrepreneurs who know what's going on make the particular decisions in question. And I would just hope that the last thing that we would want to do when we organize a cleanup program is to say that, since that's a government function that we really need to do, that massive government subsidies and penalties with respect to alternative energy sources ought to be something that we should do as well. I would think it'd be exactly the opposite.
Good. We have a question here. Can I see if there's another question so we can start to move the mic there? We've got a question in back, and then we'll come up here. Yep.
My name is Chris Anderson. I'm a 1L, and my question is for you, Ms. Salzman. The reaction to the spill, particularly, I want to talk about dispersants. As far as I can tell, a lot of people knew that dispersants were harmful. And rather than one toxic chemical in the water, now you had two. And I was wondering, what is the function of a dispersant and the charge that perhaps dispersants were introduced for the point of obfuscating the discovery of the amount of oil that was in the water?
So we need to crisply ask a question.
What was the purpose of the dispersants, okay, and why did the administration allow them to continue?
Sure. Well, that decision was made by the Environmental Protection Agency, who had the scientific analysis and capacity to make that decision. The purpose of using dispersants is to take large amounts of oil and disperse them, make them small enough for the naturally occurring microbial things that live in the ocean. Actually, there's a lot of gas and oil that comes out naturally at the bottom of the ocean. And so what the purpose of using dispersants is to break the oil up into small enough bits so those critters can eat it. There was a report issued over the summer. I'm sure you've seen a ton of scientific reports, and the National Ocean and Atmospheric Administration has concluded that due to microbial activity and skimming and burning and natural dissipation of the oil, that about 3/4 of it has been accounted for. And there was a recent study 2 weeks ago that was reported, I think, through Science Magazine, that you may or may not have heard about this cloud or I can't remember what there's sort of this
subsurface
plume. Oil plume that was discovered in June. A report that was based on data in August actually discovered that there was a new kind of microbe that had evolved and had been eating it. So it seems, I mean, it's a tough question whether to apply something. I mean, it was kind of a lesser of evils at that point. And I think EPA, based on their best judgment, Administrator Jackson said that dispersants were the better choice, and it seems as if that is playing out to have been the case.
Just a quick comment. I mean, I think when things like this happen, you have to make quick decisions, right? It's sort of a Sophie's choice. I mean, another kind of benefit of dispersants is it takes more oil away from the surface, right, with these sheens, and arguably prevented less of the oil from hitting from hitting shore, which then it becomes much more difficult to clean it up. And especially if it gets in wetlands, I mean, you don't have many options. You tear up the wetlands or you burn it, right? On the flip side of that, though, the Sophie's choice is, you know, we don't know much about it. With seafood, what we have seen from the data is that, you know, dispersants, they do break them into small little particles. And I mean, in some cases, it makes it more bioavailable to crustaceans to actually absorb it and absorb the oil that might not have entered into their body. So, I mean, it's a You can always look back with hindsight again, but I mean, I think, again, the point I was making earlier is that this goes to a flaw within the way that we regulate toxics. I mean, and there's a toxic reform effort that many of you, I'm sure, are aware of, which ideally, if it were in place, would prevent very little, chemicals with little science from being used at such a large scale.
I just want to add one thing. One of the criteria for the dispersants to be on the list that EPA had approved that BP used was that they actually biodegrade. And so that's been a big, I think there's been some confusion about that up there.
There's a question all the way in the back, and then the next question is going to be right here. Gentleman with tie.
Hi, I'm Colleen Raspberry. I'm a 1L. And I was just wondering if the federal government or the Obama administration is contemplating a more centralized sort of approach to these types of issues. We have NOAA, we have Department of Interior, we have EPA. They all are responsible for different types of permits getting issued and responding to different types of issues. But in something like this, we see they all get lumped together. So I was just curious if you could speak to that.
Yeah. First of all, the Obama administration, we have tried very hard to look across departments and agencies in all environmental matters, and that's actually a key role for CEQ, is to bring everybody around the table. So with respect to, as I described, with respect to the permitting process, CEQ has been involved with the Department of Interior, who has the lead authority on the Outer Continental Shelf. We also led an interagency task force on ocean policy. The purpose of which actually was to do just that with respect to our ocean resources and our coasts and our Great Lakes. And so we now have created an ongoing structure chaired by both CEQ and the Office of Science and Technology Policy to ensure that the government works kind of more coherently across our various jurisdictional lines.
Can I make a comment? As a general comment, I usually place little confidence in the fact that these reorganizations are going to make A, profound differences, and B, necessarily positive differences. I think all that we've known from the study of institutional behavior is that you cannot assume that more centralization is, in fact, going to lead to improvements. It may take small divisions, which are very viable when they're independently, and simply squash them into insignificance when they're put as part of larger organizations. The information flows may go such that the dominant group sort of wipes out everybody else. All that one wants to say is you can't oppose these things in principle, but you can't endorse them in principle either. Economies of scale and organizational behavior are areas of intense study where there's systematically a low rate of return on what you get by making these changes. There's a lot of false optimism in this business.
Let me just add a brief footnote. But in this case, what Amy is trying to do is fall so far short of centralization, just trying to make sure people are talking to one another and not working at cross purposes, and that's a good thing.
We have a question here, and then let's bring the mic all the way around to the gentleman in the blue, if you don't mind. Right over here.
My name is Peter Milianich. I'm a 3L here. I have a small question and a small plug. I'll start with the plug. The plug is that we're having a symposium on October 22nd related to Arctic governance, and it's going to implicate a lot of the same issues here, but up in the Arctic. So if you're interested in those issues, come to that. And Professor Epstein, you're welcome to attend, of course.
Radioactive already, huh?
I've worked at CEQ and NRDC, and I've done a little bit of work for Professor Stewart, so Professor Epstein, this question is for you also. It's not on climate change.
I thought you were going to volunteer to work for him.
Maybe someday. But this is a targeted one. What do you think about the Feinberg Commission, the sort of considerations that have gone into liability that they've been talking about, and what do you so what's your opinion? If there's anything you could change about their approach, what would it be? And what do you think the people of the Gulf would have to say about that?
Ken Feinberg is a man whom you have to see to believe. He's not very good at throwing punches, but he is the best public administrator I've ever seen at sort of ducking them. And so one of the reasons why it's extremely difficult to make any comment about the Feinberg Commission is whenever you start to put somebody to Ken Feinberg, his first response is to agree with you and then to add a but, and by the time you're done with the buts, you don't know what the agreement meant. And I think this is the following problem, is he will be faced with a set of demands which will be inconsistent with the resources that he has available to him. I don't know of all the decisions that he's made, but I do believe that he's taken one that nothing that we give you is by way of settlement and release. It's only by way of down payment. I think under these circumstances, that has to be the right decision, and let me explain why. If you compare this to what he wanted to do with the 9/11 Commission, death of 3,000 people is a horrible event, but the way in which events will play out afterwards won't give you much information on what it is that you're supposed to do. One of the real problems with the oil spill is figuring out what the estimated future transformations will start to take place, and if you try to give people lump sum settlements, they're not going to accept them because of that difficulty. So I think he made the right one on that. I think he also made the right kind of assumption to say that liability, as we're concerned here, is not with an issue, and that the hard questions are going to be, and this is something on which he won't have a policy, because you can't have a policy, it's what are the permissible items of damage that you're going to include, both by category and then the valuation with respect to particular cases. As I understand what Ken has said is, you know, I'll see it when I see it and I'll tell you when I get it. That's very unassuring to people who are convinced that he's got some deep plot behind him. But generally speaking, when messes are created either by nature or by political organization, the solution is not going to be a lot cleaner than the mess that you're trying to get rid of. And I can't think of a simple rule for this particular circumstances that will handle it. Generally speaking, legal rules, simplicity and clarity work at the initial stage to stop things from going off the rails. But once some guy's in mistakes and somebody else makes another mistake, you get exactly what they said with respect to all of these dispersants. Everybody's making tough judgments contingent upon somebody else's previous mistake, and it's real hard to be angry at them if they make a mistake. And so I would take my good friend and give him at least a modicum of good faith deference before he gets eaten alive by people who are disappointed at the amount of money they receive.
So let's move the front mic right here to Ms. Bywitz. Do you still want to ask a question?
Yeah.
And we're here.
Yeah, my name's Sam Dastrup. I'm a fellow at the Furman Center and an economist by training. This question is a response to Mr. Epstein's suggesting that the defense should raise an objection to a multiplicative claims to damages. And just a question then for the panel, given that we're dealing with a public good that's by nature non-rival here, that the benefits to the use of the Gulf and the beaches, et cetera, are non-rival, meaning they accrue to various parties without diminishing the enjoyment of the other parties, what sort of a legal framework then is there for addressing these claims that are in by nature of the resource multiplicative reference to this idea that the defense should say, well, we can't face everyone, it should be a unified group.
Do you want to take that one, Amy?
No, gosh.
There's certainly the whole problem about non-rival uses is one of the dominant characteristics of water law, which is always trying to figure out how you get in-stream and out-of-stream uses together, and anytime you just get an ordinary 19th century pollution case, you get identical questions with respect to the claims. My view is not that you ignore the non-rival claims and sort of treat them as zero. It's the question is whether or not for any given non-rival claim, there are two sorts of people going to be able to claim the same element with respect to damages. And so, for example, if there's a loss of wildlife and somebody says, you know, this is a terrible loss and I want all the damages because I'm the fisherman who's going to collect them, and then somebody says, I want all the loss because I'm not going to collect them at all, but I think that they're just wonderful within the sea, it's very hard to say how the same fish is going to do double service as being an element within the sea after it's been eaten by somebody outside the sea. And so what you want to try to do is to figure out precise delineations of what the claims are and to make sure that they're consistent. The usual legal method for that is, again, to try and bring all the relevant claimants in at the same time so that you don't get whipsawed. The difficulty with that is an insuperably difficult administrative kind of procedure. What one hope would do is you would start to see essentially individual groups form, and then those groups deal with other groups so that instead of having one-on-one type claims, you have essentially amalgamation of parallel claims, come up with some omnibus solution. What Dick Stewart said is surely correct. You try to litigate these under the standards of a tort action in an individualized cases. By the time people get anything, everybody will be dead. And so what you have to do is to make rough and ready judgments, which give you approximately where you would like to be, perhaps a little bit less, on the grounds that speed and disposition is more important than accuracy and outcome when you have a crisis of this magnitude.
Let me just supplement that with the point about natural resource damages. And in the Exxon Valdez spill, whose fish is it? Is it Alaska's? Is it ours? You know. Now, the practical thing is we had to stick together with the state. That is, the lawyers. So there were various trustee agencies in the state. There were various federal trustees. But we lawyers somehow stuck together. I found dealing with Alaska very difficult. I'm sure there are Alaskans here. But at least some of the people I dealt with had more than a touch of paranoia, in my view. They had similar views of people in Washington, I'm sure. We managed to stick together. Now, here it's going to be a problem sticking together when you have a number of states. Because if you don't stick together, the defense lawyer is going to divide and conquer, right? And play them off one another. So we had to stick together. So that's one problem. Then the second problem, you get a pot of money from some settlement. How's it going to be spent? And there, I think Congress just punted on this issue in the statutes of trustees. No, and maybe they had to. But I think, and I'm again, I urge the administration to try to be creative here, to have some single decision-making entity to make sure this is spent well, to really protect the Gulf insofar as we can.
We have a question here. I'm just curious where we've got hands elsewhere in the room.
Why the distributional requirement?
You actually are only looking at what you're observing instead of what the real rule really is. And so you may be perplexed, but I'd be glad to describe it to you later.
Hey, Barry.
That's precisely right. It's advanced payment is the rule. And so we've got another question right up here in the front, if we could bring the other mic here. Yep.
I'm Alice Biowitz. I'm a 2L. And I wonder, to what extent, if at all, will the BP report and its claims about BP's diminished responsibility for the spill affect BP's desire, its willingness to settle, and also the level of the settlement?
What is the report?
I understood that BP issued a report.
Oh, its report.
Yes, its report.
Well, I'll give you an answer. These reports are extremely complicated because sometimes what they do is they result in aggravated damages if everybody regards this as a cover-up rather than a serious inquiry. So you can't even be sure of the sign of the vector. My own view about it is that the report is no better than the evidence which is contained in the report. And if it's good evidence, they could introduce it at trial. And if it's bad evidence, they damn well ought not to keep it out. My sense is that the importance of this as a political document is to try to set the frame of discourse, particularly for the Feinberg settlements. But until somebody has a chance to read it and to cross-examine it, I don't think you can make a confident judgment on that question.
This woman here, and then there's a hand right in the back there. Gentleman's got his hand up. Sooner or later, we'll get to him. I'm worried about his question. Yeah.
Hi, I'm Ital Dror. I'm a LLM environmental law, and my question is to Professor Epstein. I personally believe that the only way that these companies will stop spilling oil is by making them pay money, and a lot of it. And the moment that you cause such a great oil spill, you're an open target, and anyone who can sue should sue.
I'm going to give the following answer. I did not defend this case as BP's unpaid and unloved representative on the grounds that they should escape liability. But you know, one of the difficulties with deterrence is there's too little, which you're worried about, and there's too much, which we also have to worry about. And in this particular case, for example, let me explain what the dangers of too much deterrence can be. If you're a believer in a strict liability theory, as I generally tend to be, you're going to have to figure out how you insure against those risks. If what you do, in effect, is to falsely attribute to BP those particular elements of damages which are more accurately attributable to government or other private actors, what you're going to do is to give an insurance premium that's going to be too high. you're going to then shut down the well. And it turns out when you shut down one well, it doesn't eliminate environmental damages. It asks the question of what's the alternative source of energy that you're going to start to produce. Somebody will say, oh, well, you just use these wonderful little turbines, right? Well, it turns out turbines create a kind of air pollution that disrupt the operation of radar, which leads the Navy now to sue in order to block them. And the only way you can deal with environmental stuff in a world in which there are alternative hazards from alternative technologies is to price them all accurately. And in effect, what you're announcing for is I want to have a punitive damage element built into this thing, at which point what you will do is you'll get too much kinds of bad stuff coming out of other sources for other reasons. And my attitude is, now I'm not speaking as a BP representative, is that accurate valuation lies at the heart of many of us most difficult social questions.
I just have a different take on that
the microphone back on. No.
I think deterrents do work. I mean, if you look at what caused the oil spill, it was a long track record BP had for willful violation of safety rules, not only under OSHA, but other statutes as well. A great example is under OSHA in the past 2 years, BP has had 154 willful violations of state. One that led to a refinery explosion that killed, more than 20 people, actually. And 11 is a lot of people as well. But Exxon had one in that period of time. So, in some cases, I think, zealously prosecuting these does lead to deterrent as far as, behavior that leads to some of these types of accidents.
My theory essentially would say that on average, given what you said, Exxon will pay a lot less than will BP. And the second thing I want is so that the deterrence theory still says you want optimality, and optimality will reflect that difference. But you certainly don't want to get yourself into the position where you start picking the wrong modalities. Let me mention one thing. As best I can tell from the industry, people that I've talked to, Exxon got religion after Exxon Valdez. And in fact, at this point, you cannot go to an Exxon meeting unless you first identify the fire exits inside the room. And that's in fact what they do as an internal protocol. But I'm also told by some people who work in this industry that for deep water drilling, the single best company in the world is, in fact, BP, notwithstanding this insanely thing. I'm told that. I don't know if it's true. But the last thing you want to do is to infer that you ought to keep them out of the deep water drilling stuff because they have OSHA violations. You want to make sure that you segment the operation so that you put the sanctions where they belong and don't have negative spillover from them.
When you say you were told that, I'm teaching about the reliability of informants right after this, so you feel free to come to class.
My name is Ari Glogauer. I'm a 2L, and this is a question for whoever has some thoughts on it. One distinction that seems relevant to me from the Exxon case is that this time BP were dealing with what's essentially an iconic British company, a large proportion of which is still owned by British shareholders. And I'm wondering if the international relations aspect is going to play into any subsequent litigation or settlement, and what it'll look like for what will, to a large extent, be the American government and courts going up against British pensioners.
Well, I think it shouldn't, and it won't.
Replaced its British president with a guy who came up through the American side of the business. This will die as an issue.
Can move the mic up to this patiently waiting gentleman in the white shirt. And is there another question? So this gentleman in the jacket's been waiting a long time as well.
Work? Yeah. And this is probably a question most particularly for Ms. Salzman, but I'd be curious what anybody has to say about it. To what extent should we view this particularly as a deep water drilling disaster, and in what ways can we generalize this to the offshore oil drilling industry generally?
Well, it was a deep water drilling disaster, so I guess it belongs in that box, but I would just, I would clarify that the review that we did of DOI's processes were broader than that. And so right now, their use of categorical exclusions applies writ large. And their review of their NEPA processes also apply writ large. And they are actually defining some of the distinctions between whether there's a blowout preventer device, which is the thing that didn't work to stop the oil in this instance, is sitting on the bottom of the ocean or up on the platform. So it is broader than deep water drilling.
That provokes me back to the question, Al and Richard were talking about the OSHA violations, I think any prosecutor is going to take into account, is this company a bad apple or not? And a bad apple can be shown in a management style that cuts across different types of violations. And I think it's appropriate to take that into account.
I regard that as not the dominant feature. I think the most powerful element in this particular case is the sort of well-specific violations that seem to have cropped up. And I mean, if I were a prosecutor and I had 75 major mistakes done in the handling of this particular well, that's what I would want to focus on. If I were BP, you know, you're going to play the strategy that Dick wants to play. If this turns out to have been a rogue manager and you've got everybody else on their deep well water wells doing just fine, you know, that could come in on the other side. But I do not think, in effect, that it would be effective for a prosecutor to start talking about OSHA violations having to do with vents in men's room to try to figure out why it is that this thing blew up, I mean, as a strategy device. And I think painting too wide actually turns out in many cases to be counterproductive.
Proposing on the trial of the case to introduce the men's room violations, but that in there's enormous discretion in these statutes, right? There's enormous range of penalties you can ask for. It's going to be negotiated out, but you know how hard you're going to push is going to be based on your judgment about how responsibly the company was managed.
True in police settlements.
Just one note to add, I mean, everyone reads about the BP spill, but there are spills all the time in shallow water and deep water that maybe people just don't hear about that often. I think the BP one, there's discretion involved in and part of it is, you know, how much people pay attention to it. I mean, you might have heard since the BP spill, there have been several incidents in the Gulf Coast, as well as pipeline accidents around the country. So. I think generally what it does speak to is, you know, is this industry that we are regulating appropriately and are keeping an eye on, and are they kind of running roughshod over our regulatory system?
This is likely to be our last question.
Hi, my name is John Wood. I'm a 3L. The federal government auctioned off
into the mic.
The federal government auctioned off these drilling leases, and you know, the companies put together feasibility studies to see what they could do and whether they could make a profit and still do this safely. And I understand that BP outbid these companies by a wide margin. And I'm wondering why that didn't raise any red flags about their ability to do this safely.
Good question.
I guess, are you looking for me to answer something?
Go ahead, Amy.
You know, I don't have an answer for you. It was done within the Department of the Interior, and I've never heard what you just said, actually.
I could give you two answers, and they're completely inconsistent with one another. One of them is these guys didn't care much about the safety issue, so they were going to take fewer precautions. And the other one is they thought they were so good technically relative to everybody else that they could bid higher because it reflected their massive efficiencies. And until you get the internal documents, you're not sure which, but let me give you the following argument in favor of BP from this. Generally speaking, efficiencies and high performance don't get you in multi-billion dollar lawsuits. We're cutting corners in a world in which you know what the environmental exposures are due. So if I had to pick between the two explanations, if I were the BP guy, I'm saying this was conclusive proof that we thought we were better than everybody else. We're not so crazy as to really want to invite this stuff. And on that happy note, I will resign as a representative of the company.
I'm wondering how long it will be between now and your phone ringing in your office. Before we thank everyone here, I just want to say tell you something about the upcoming forum. So the next week, the forum will be in a different room, so watch. And it's going to be on how to write your substantial writing paper. So that may not seem quite as stimulating, but it's equally important.
Steve will be talking.
Yeah, yes. He's actually on every forum this semester. Then the week after that, we're going to do an evening forum on a Thursday about Darfur and crimes against women with Catherine McKinnon and Jose Alvarez. And after that, U.S. versus Arizona and immigration, and then a Supreme Court roundup. So we've got a great program ahead. Why don't we thank these guys? It was terrific.